All right, looks like we've got the majority of people here this afternoon. I'd like to welcome you all to this afternoon session. I have the privilege to introduce the next speaker, who is Rod Farah. Rod is a director of Paladin Risk Management Services, creator of Risk Gladiators. Following 20 years as an officer in the Australian Army, Rod's channeled his passion and skill for managing risk and now applies his extensive experience in assisting organisations to mitigate and eliminate professional risks they may encounter. Rod's got extensive experience in delivery of professional consultancy services to the government, corporate and not-for-profit sectors. And he draws on his 20 years as a army officer in varying project security and operational roles. Rod's lectured at the University of Canberra, as well as speaking at a range of conferences and forums. I'd like you to welcome Rod, together with me.
Thank you. Oh, I'm mic'd up. I can't stand behind a lectern. It just doesn't work. Welcome. You want to start the thingy so that I know when I'm going to get the bell? Thank you. How many of us, just a little straw poll, how many of us have either used the terminology or have heard people within our organisation say, our goal is to make sure that risk management's embedded into everything we do? Yeah? How many of you have actually succeeded? Yeah. The numbers are a lot less, aren't they? Because the reality is, what does that look like? What does embedded risk management look like? So that's what we're going to talk about today, the embedded risk management, whether it's the holy grail or achievable outcome. What if I was to actually tell you before we even start that you already have risk management embedded into your organisation? You just don't know it. That's the key to what I'm going to talk about over this next little while. And I'll start with a story. There was a guy that came on one of my courses from Bunnings. And we were talking around all things risk, as you do on a risk course. And he was telling a story that he had just been awarded or given $150,000 extra budget for training and awareness. You see, he worked in the plant importation and distribution part of the hardware chain. So essentially, you could imagine there would be a huge biosecurity risk. If they import plants and then send them out and something happens, that's not going to be great for their reputation. So then went on after he told me he'd just got another $150,000 to improve training and awareness and said, all right, well, tell me, what other controls do you have in place? And he started listing them. And they were enormous, number of controls. I said, well, how do you know that they're effective? And he went through and he listed all of the things and how he knew that those controls were effective. But then I asked the killer question. Geez, you must have a good risk register. And he said, what risk register? But what's the key there? He didn't have a risk register, but was he managing that risk? And that is the key. And it comes down to this. Very few things, if any, will happen within an organisation that haven't happened before. There are exceptions, of course, because we do live in an uncertain world. But the reality is, very few things are going to happen in a council, a hospital, a university, a school, a childcare facility that haven't happened before. How do we know that? You just got to go and look at the incident reports and so forth. So what does that mean for us? What it means in practice is that for the most part, we already have all of the controls in place that we will ever need. So what does that mean? It means our focus needs to be on the effectiveness of those existing controls. How many of you have got risk registers with heaps and heaps of treatments in them? Yeah? Anyone got... Can I tell you the story? This one came from a student as well. They had a risk in the risk register which was low staff morale. The treatment? Give them something to believe in. It was magnificent. For me, the thing that I'm starting to talk with clients about and talk with organisations about is that for the most part, treatment is an exception. Because if you already have all of the controls you need in place and you add some treatments, as we'll talk about a little bit later on, it can increase risk. So, fundamental to all of this is to identify our controls, particularly relating to those with the highest consequence risks. We then develop measures of effectiveness, and we then measure and report that effectiveness. How many of us do have the option in our risk registers to identify the controls? Yeah? How many of you then make an assessment around control effectiveness? How many of you do that through free text? How many of you actually measure the effectiveness of those controls as opposed to say, well, nothing's happened, so it must be effective? There is a big, big difference between the two. So, controls. As you know, control is something already in place that is there to reduce risk within an organization. Often they've been put in place because of an incident that's occurred. If you look at all of the regulation and the legislation that you are now subject to in your organizations, the majority of that has come because incidents have occurred and they've tried to put a regulatory framework over the top to stop it happening again. But if you go back and look at all of the incidents in your organization, you will find that well in excess of 90% of those have occurred not because of a lack of controls, but because of a failure of the existing controls. Now, what happens if we don't identify it was a failure in controls and we start to put new controls in place? If we haven't actually solved the problems with the first ones, we will find ourselves putting new controls over the top, spreading the resources wider, to the point where you can actually conceivably put new treatments or new controls in place and actually raise the likelihood of a risk occurring. Now, that's not something that we really have heard that much, but in reality, if we're adding controls upon controls upon controls, and those controls are still ineffective, we're now spreading the love across multiple controls. And for those of you who understand the Swiss cheese model, we've just made those holes even bigger. So more treatments does not necessarily mean we're reducing the risk. So what we have to do is reduce the or avoid this knee-jerk reaction. Now, I was just in Brisbane recently, and we're talking about the horrific bus driver incident where he was doused with fluids and we actually had somebody from the business from Brisbane City Council in the course. And I said, this is what's going to happen. You're going to look at that incident and you're going to say, oh my God, that's a tragedy. And people are going to start to say, why wasn't there protection there? And so the whole of the bus lines are now going to be fitted with that Perspex screen. Have they reduced the risk that they're going to have people getting doused with stuff and burn? Well, those things have got holes in them. So we may not have reduced that risk. But they did the same in the taxi industry. Remember all of that a few years ago where they were getting beaten up and they put all of those screens in? Do you see any taxis with screens in them now? They actually were harder to operate in. It raised the driver's temperatures. It became a safety issue, and so they removed them all. We need to avoid this knee-jerk reaction of being seen to do something and think more about, well, what failed and why did it fail? So we need to ensure when we're looking at our risks that we understand what controls are in place and how effective they are. For me, risk management is all about the humble control. If your controls are effective, then the majority of the things that you're worried about won't happen. And you've already got them in place. And what we need to understand is there is a direct correlation between the effectiveness of your controls and the likelihood and or the consequence occurring. And it may follow, doesn't it? The less effective your controls, the more likely something is going to happen. And yet when it does happen, the first instinct is to say, well, what am I going to put in place? So one of the rules of thumb that I use, for every cause that you identify for a risk, there should be at least one control. If there isn't, it may be something you need to consider to determine whether there is a need for any other controls. But focus primarily on the current control environment. So how do we identify them? One of the things that I'm using now with organizations is to link the controls to the actual causes. In this case, we've got a worker falling from heights. Causes: no safety equipment provided, failure of safety equipment, worker fails to wear it, lack of ineffective training or induction, a lack of ineffective supervision. What you can see there is we can see the controls straight next to it, or right next to each of those causes. And we can understand, therefore, whether we have control coverage on that. What might be some of the other things that you discover after you put controls next to causes? Other than the fact you might have gaps, what's the big thing you might find? Anyone? Control can do multiple things. They are very special, our controls. What else? You might be over-controlled. You may be over-controlled to the point where you no longer actually are effective because you've got too many controls in there. Here's one for disruption to waste collection for those of you who might be in council. Contractor goes into receivership. Industrial action of the contractor, vehicle fleet grounded. We put controls in next to those and identify the effectiveness of those controls. But we also need to understand that there is a criticality to our controls. And what I mean by that is it needs to be recognized that not all of the controls against each of those causes is going to have the same impact in terms of reducing the risk. There will be those that are absolutely critical that if they're ineffective or partially effective will mean that the likelihood of that risk is increased. If we treat or if we look at the effectiveness of all of those controls, we may actually be allocating too many resources. So assigning our criticality is going to assist us with a range of things, not the least of which is our audit program, and I'll explain the relationship to that in a little while. So this is something that I've developed, where I look at each of the controls against each of the risks, and I'll assign it a control criticality. So criticality 5, the control is absolutely critical to the management and reduction of the risk. If this control is ineffective or partially ineffective, the likelihood and or the consequence of this risk will increase significantly. What we're talking about there is up to 3 levels. So it goes from being a rare to a likely or an unlikely up to an almost certain. And then the rest of it flows. Down to the criticality 2s and 1s. If this is not a regulated or legislated requirement to be doing this control and it's only criticality 1, you've got to be asking the question, why are you doing it? So we're now linking all of our risks to controls and the environment. So here's an example of how we might use this, and we're going to look at this in a resource-constrained environment. So this particular port, they've got 2 berths. The first berth is their full-on working berth. If that goes down for a period of time through a material failure in their infrastructure, they will find some severe consequences very, very quickly. Berth 2, on the other hand, their consequences are only going to be fairly moderate because it's only used about 20 days of the year. Now, the controls are exactly the same. The criticality is exactly the same. But we can use consequence in this case to say, this is where we need to really put our effort. And if we are in a resource-constrained environment, we can say, well, we're going to double up in that area and have less in the other area, so that we are still getting an understanding of the effectiveness of the controls commensurate with the severity of the consequence. And this will be a theme I talk about in a moment. So how do we measure control effectiveness? It's a question that's plagued a lot of people. As I said, we get into the room and we say those controls are effective because nothing's happened. We need to understand that assumption does not equal assurance. Just because we have a control in place doesn't mean that it's effective. And an absence of incident does not necessarily mean your control is effective. In a lot of cases, it means you've been very, very lucky. And that luck may run out sometime. So the only true way to determine the effectiveness of your controls is actually to measure the effectiveness of your controls. So what does that mean for us? It means that we need performance measures and KPIs against our controls, particularly those critical ones. So what I've developed is a three lines of defense model, because we need to recognize that not all controls need to have that effectiveness measures, or those effectiveness measures, because the impost or the resource impost would be fairly significant. So the first thing that we do is we prioritize our controls. And I do that through using a matrix like this. I identify the consequence of the risk. And I look at the criticality of the control. So if it's a severe consequence with a criticality of 3, 4, or 5, it is a priority one control. Now, a priority one control in this case means we have no wiggle room. That control needs to be effective, and we need evidence to support that. We then have the majors with the criticality 4 and 5 being 2, and then moderates with criticality 5 being 3. But so what? We then need to plot that into a matrix like this. So the three lines of defense for control effectiveness. First line, control self-assessment. And I'm sure some of you have already got ways within the organization to do control self-assessment, where the control owner understands the control and the operation of that control, and they can make some judgments around the strength of that control and the effectiveness of that control. The second line of defense, we're talking about either line management review or the use of internal audit. And then the third line of defense is the use of external audit. So as you can see, what we've got down here is priority one. We do control self-assessment. Our second line of defense is our internal audit. And where appropriate and where possible, our third line of defense is external audit. And that goes to the priority two ones as well. When we get down to the priority threes, we do a control self-assessment, we do line management review as the second line, and we do internal audit as the third line. All other controls, just control self-assessment. What is this giving us? This is actually giving us an understanding of the most important controls in an organization. Those controls that are attached to the highest consequence risks if they were to occur. Now, if we understand the controls that would be against those highest consequence risks and understand that we need to make those effective or keep those effective to stop this stuff happening, then we've fed into our audit program. Now, we will see things like this: not effective, partially effective, moderately effective, effective. But how do we come up with which one that is? And we can do that through developing performance measures. So if you see or think back to our example of the docks, we've got here risk, catastrophic material failure of infrastructure. The causes: first cause, lack of or ineffective maintenance. We have a range of controls there. The preventative routine maintenance, we've got an inspection program, and we've got certification. We can actually start to put performance measures against those. Percentage of routine maintenance tasks carried out in accordance with designated timeframes. Percentage of maintenance inspections carried out within designated timeframes, etc., etc. The key here is we are putting performance measures against those critical controls. But then you need something that identifies what effective looks like. So for our percentage of routine maintenance, 100% of routine maintenance conducted within designated timeframes, we call that effective. Right through to less than 50% of routine maintenance, it's not effective. Now, if you're sitting at 45%, what does that tell us? Not only are we not effective, we kind of need to do something about it to actually raise the effectiveness. But if we're all sitting in a room and we ask the question, are those controls effective? The answer might come back, well, nothing's collapsed. So therefore, they must be effective. Now, here's one where we've got the double banger, where we've got two controls in there. So we look at 100%, 80 to 99%, but then down here, 50 to 79% of maintenance inspections and anything less than 79% of issues. It's up to you what you do with those. But the key here is not only are you measuring the control effectiveness, you are integrating both into your performance framework and your internal audit program, because you have now set or given an understanding of those critical controls that need to be audited. But then, wait, there's more. Just simply saying that, yes, we're doing all of those things is not enough. We do need to measure the conformance against all of those, but certainly we also, in some cases, may need to test the environment, test the control environment. So I'll give you an example. Child kidnapped from a childcare centre. In this particular case, here's all of our controls, these are our performance measures, these are our key performance indicators, and we're actually achieving 100% against those. Compared to if they were 50%, have we reduced the likelihood that a child is going to be kidnapped from our childcare centre? Yes. Hello. We have. Have we gotten rid of it altogether? No, we haven't. So what can we do? What can we do to test the environment? Anyone? Anyone? You know you're thinking it. Let's try and steal a child. Now, I'm not suggesting you get a hobo and give him 20 bucks and say, see if you can get Jimmy. What you do is you have a relative of one of the children come in who's not on the sign-out sheet. And if that child is released into their custody, there is something wrong in the control environment. And it makes sense, doesn't it? When we build IT systems, what do? We try and break them. When we build jails, we try and get people to break out of them. That's why I was in jail. It wasn't for anything else. So we end up in a situation where the controls failed despite having 100% conformance. What does that then lead us to do? We go back and we review. We go back and say, realistically, are they all the controls that we need? Or do we need to microchip the children as well? That way they won't go. So this is the key to it for me. The highest consequence risks within an organization need to be our focus. I see risk matrices that have got risks that are almost certain but minor, or almost certain insignificant, at being listed as high risks. If it's insignificant or minor, it's noise. It's noise. It shouldn't even go into a risk register. That's what you pay managers to deal with. How many of you have been in a situation where someone comes in the morning and says, oh my God, boss, I've got an issue. Better put that in the risk register. It's noise. So we need to understand that where our focus needs to lie, and this follows on from what we were just talking about in the last session, focus on those with the highest level consequence. Because if they are not effective, then the likelihood and or consequence of those highest consequence risks are going to be higher. So we need to ensure that the focus is in our internal audit program. What percentage, outside of a finance industry organisation, but let's say a hospital or a university or a childcare centre, what percentage of controls in that organisation do you think the critical controls would be financial? Many? Not many at all. But what's our internal audit program looking at? Whether we're using our cab charge dockets appropriately. What we're spending our credit cards on. And yet we may be actually missing undertaking effectiveness assessments of the things that are the most important, most critical controls in our organisation. How many of you do believe that you've got high consequence risks within your organisation? I would hope all of you. How do you know that they are rare or unlikely? Is it anything to do with frequency? Or is it to do with the strength of your control? Here's a question that I pose to people. Let's say we're a restaurant and we've got a risk in our risk register, contaminated food served to restaurant patrons. If you take the traditional way of looking at risk management and likelihood, you're going to ask the question, well, how many times has that happened previously? Well, it hasn't happened in the last 5 years, so let's put it as rare. But is it truly rare? Is the likelihood of that particular risk occurring got anything to do with frequency whatsoever? Or is it not happening because of the strength of your controls? You could have had a plated, hatted restaurant that hasn't had one for 5 years. You could have Uncle Jimmy's kebab shop that hasn't had one for 5 years. But these guys have got no controls in place, they've just been really lucky. And these guys have got the controls. So certainly the way I'm look at likelihood now is it's got nothing to do with frequency. In fact, most of the risks that you will have in your organization have nothing to do with frequency. It's all about the strength of your controls and the control environment. That's what's keeping those risks low, or that likelihood low, not time. So the process, the first thing that we need to do is to identify the risks within our organisation that have the highest consequence should they occur. We then identify the controls reducing the likelihood of those risks occurring, and we incorporate those controls into our audit program after having allocated performance frame of performance measures and KPIs. And then we're providing status of the control effectiveness to our risk owners. So how does an audit team work? Is anyone here an auditor? I was going to say, let's talk about them. But often you will have the auditors go off and do their audit. They will find all of the non-conformances and they will write reports. And if you're really lucky, they'll also do a risk register for you as well. But the reality is, the process that we need to be using is this. We have our high consequence risks. We identify those critical controls. Those controls then become subject to our internal audit program. What we find out of this audit is not reported to the executive. It needs to go back to the control owners. And the control owners subsequently need to inform the risk owners. Why? Because if those controls that they have thought were effective are now no longer effective, that could actually change the level of the risk. It could change the level of the risk because the likelihood may have now gone up. And we need to be able to understand that. Because then the risk owner can report to the committees to say, look, this particular risk is now higher because one of the controls that we thought was effective is now no longer effective. And we can ask them to make some investment decisions, which I term risk-informed decisions, about what they're going to do in terms of that risk. So the focus becomes what I call consequence-based internal auditing. Regardless of likelihood, you need to understand those controls associated with the highest consequence risks and then make sure that they're effective. And what happens? Stuff stops happening. Even that. Stuff stops happening. And that's when your managers say, look how good my leadership is. We're not having all those things happening anymore. Now, this then leads us on to risk reporting. And we saw all of those beautiful things that, like the overview of the top risks to the organization, the top 10. Who reports their top 10 or 15 or 20 risks? Yeah, yeah. You might whack a heat map in there as well, just for good measure. Issues or incidents that arise during the auditing period or the period, and your audit results. And of course, we get a wide array of pretty colored things, don't we? As long as they use color, it's all good. But then, if you can add dials, you are all over this stuff. But here's the thing. If you're putting these sort of reports up in front of management, they cannot make risk-informed decisions, because all you are doing is providing them a status or a snapshot. You're not telling them anything. But if we use a report where we're focusing on the consequence or the risks with the highest level consequence, regardless of the likelihood, and using consequence-based reporting, we get a very, very different approach. So here's an example. We've got the child kidnapped from childcare centre. We've got all of our controls down here. We've got effective and mostly effective for all of them. And we can put reasons behind that. So at this stage, it's a rare likelihood. It's a major consequence, except for the child, obviously. It's a major consequence, which brings it out at a medium risk. We ask the question, do we need any additional controls at this point of time? And the answer is that is no. Are there any decisions required by the board or the committee? Now, let's say that one of the key controls is good fencing. I don't know about you, but if I have my child going to a childcare centre, I want them to kind of stay in. And the fencing is old, and we're starting to see some bits of the fence that are being held together by chicken wire. So that control is now only partially effective. Would you agree that the likelihood of a child being kidnapped has potentially gone up? Would you also agree that management want to know about that? And if we put it up there as partially effective and say it's not rare anymore, it's now gone to unlikely, so that risk has gone up a level from medium to high. Decision required. Invest the money to get a new fence. What if they say no? What have they done? They've accepted the risk on behalf of the organisation. They have made a risk-informed decision to actually accept that risk on behalf of the organisation. And you know they're going to blame you when little Jimmy gets kidnapped, don't you? You didn't tell me it properly. It is a different way of approaching it. So the report structures that I'm building now with some of my clients don't have the heat maps. They don't have the dials. We still use colour because that's important. But what it's putting in front of them is the ability to make a risk-informed decision based on the strength of the controls. So what does all of that mean? In summary, you've pretty much got all of the controls you'll ever need in place within your organisation. Secondly, if you can determine which of those are linked to the highest consequence risks and make sure those are effective, you are going to reduce incidents. What are you doing? You're actually managing risk. You're going back to what we talked about, our Bunnings story. So what does that mean for the future of risk registers? For me, and as I said to the Bunnings guy, I still think you need a risk register even though you're managing that risk effectively. Because if we're able to link the controls to a higher consequence risk, we are better able to put business cases forward to say we need additional funding here. We are also better able to understand the prioritisation around the controls and the audit as well. We can't get that if we don't have that linkage to a risk register. So the key here, it's not the Holy Grail. Embedding risk management is not the Holy Grail. But I would argue that, well, how many of you have got a risk policy? Yeah? You've got a risk register, and it's reviewed every, what, 3 to 6 to 12 months, yeah? My question to you is this, to end. Are you doing risk management, or are you managing risk? And there is a massive difference between the two. What I've shown you today brings it from doing risk management to actually managing risk and embedding it not only into our organizational day-to-day processes, but also to our performance framework and to our control framework and our audit program. And in doing so, we will actually have to get people out of their silos, or as I like to call them, cylinders of excellence. We have to get them out of their silos and get people talking to each other. Wouldn't that be novel? All right, that's all I wanted to go through. More than happy to take your question. We've got 10 minutes, which is good. Look at that shock and awe.
I'll get things going.
Oh, damn.
I'm wondering, what I was thinking while you were thinking, and I thought it was fabulous to build in that criticality of controls. Do you think that can also apply to criticality of action?
Yeah. If you actually do need to go down to the process of putting new controls in place, then certainly you can prioritise those. Because the reality is this. Not all of those are going to be able to be done tomorrow or the next day. Particularly if you're in a government organisation, you actually may have to bid for these in the out years, 3 or 4 years, because it may be an infrastructure upgrade. So you need to think about prioritising those, and once they are done, they then become a current control. And that's the other thing, is that apparently there's a thing called a risk fairy, that if you put your risk register under your pillow with $2, all of your treatments get done overnight. How many of you have got treatments in there that have been there for quite some time? They don't get better with age, I tell you. So it's a really good point that once we do, if we have a treatment, it needs to go on and become a current control as well. Could we get a microphone? Just all the bombs. I can't hear nothing.
We talked about a dodgy fence at the nursery.
Yep.
And some is held up by chicken wire. Do we do something about this or not? What if you do want to do something about this? By doing that, you can reduce the risk by maybe 20%, 25%. Still stays in the same box in the matrix.
Yes, yes.
How do you make your business case?
Well, this is once again one of those things that we get very, very wedded to our matrices, don't we? And I've actually... We can use our matrix for good as well as evil. Where I've seen barrows pushed. I really need this new thing, so let's put it up higher in the matrix. And I've also seen people say to me, well, if I put it up and say it's still the same colour, then how am I going to get the money for it? So the risk part of it becomes one element of the business case. But it's also just about saying to them, look, you know, these are the consequences if they occur. And if you don't do these, then we're more likely to have that. Whether it's 10%, 15%, or 20%, it's really, really difficult to actually quantify that anyway. But is this good business practice? I think that there's a sense that we can just throw things into a likelihood of consequence and put it in a matrix and get the cookie cutter going and we come up with the answer. There is a real art to this in terms of selling that message.
But that destroys the transparency, doesn't it, of the decision?
What's that?
Well, they said, yes, we'll do this one, even though the risk is the same.
Yes.
But they said, no, we won't do this one, but the risk stays the same.
But that's them. This is the great thing about being able to escalate these things up, is you're getting them to make the risk-informed decision. And you're putting it at the level of authority that should be making those decisions. That's for me. It's just there is sometimes a very difficult to discern a difference between different likelihoods and different consequences. But you don't want to go to a 10 by 10 matrix or something just so you can get that little bit more difference.
Inform decisions,
yes,
based on a structure that can't inform your decisions. There's nothing wrong with what you're trying to do in your software. I'm saying it's built on a fragile base.
But this isn't software.
Whatever you're doing it on, whatever the comparison is with, you're saying I can make an importance of change to that, but it changes no part of anything I can show in the documentation. And yet, I want to do this one. I don't want to do that one.
I'm not sure I'm following you, because the whole
25% reduction is a very, very good reduction in risk. It won't show in any matrix. It won't show on 90% of what people use.
Yeah.
As the tool for making risk decisions.
I personally don't put numbers anywhere near risk management. Because numbers in risk management give you this false sense of granularity that doesn't exist. You don't have enough data to support that. And if you go back to the fact that I'm not using frequency for the likelihood, then 25% or 50% or whatever becomes irrelevant to that.
If you don't have data, if you don't have the estimation of the quantification, then you will do that anyone, you will do it in your mind. You will do it with 10 people sitting around the room, all making a different call on the numbers in their mind and coming to a conclusion. I'm not having a go at some of the principles you're talking about here. I'm having a go at building them on fragile ground. Gives you no coverage at all for your decision making.
Well, I would argue that control effectiveness is not fragile ground. Yeah.
Whether you move or not move.
Yeah. Okay.
Just carrying on a little from there, if I may, in clarification. If you just use the colours on the matrix, you have the problem that you've just been discussing.
Mm-hmm.
If in fact you also add numbers into those coloured squares, you will have a high which has got several different heights in numbers.
Yes.
And that gives you some granularity for those discussions about where resources should be put.
Yes and no. Because the ultimate thing is this. When we go into a risk workshop, we're identifying something that may or may not happen. We're then trying to determine the likelihood of that based on judgment and experience. And then the consequences based on judgment and experience. You put a number and say this is a 14 high versus a 17 high, and people will automatically assume you've got all of this data here that's being able to discern between a 14 and a 17. And I just don't believe that data exists in most organisations. And particularly if you go away from frequency as the measure of likelihood towards control effectiveness, then the numbers become even less relevant.
Yeah, I take your point. The frequency is not necessarily the measure of likelihood, because you measure your likelihood, yes, about the past and what's occurred, but also about judgments that may occur in the future.
But we also, and it says in the standard, we look at the likelihood and a consequence based on the effectiveness of our controls. All I'm doing is aligning a likelihood criteria that actually is pointed towards that. Because if it hasn't happened for the last 10 years, I mean, when the tsunami hit in Japan, they probably had it as a rare event because it hadn't happened for 300 years. The day it happened, were they wrong? What was it the next day? It's still rare, isn't it? So this is the vagaries, I think, with where we've been going.
Not as rare in Christchurch.
No. And for any Kiwis out here, my thoughts are with you.
Rod, a question if I may.
Oh, there we are. Yeah.
In your experience, I'm aligned to your thinking here. I'm just wondering how long, I guess, it would take, and also how difficult it is to develop performance measures for all of your critical controls.
Yeah.
So, fall from height or getting struck by a vehicle, if I'm just staying in safety space, might be easy. But then, you know, many of us have risk registers that are now starting to get into the psychosocial risks, mental health risks,
yep.
for which, you know, you may still be able to identify a critical control,
yep.
but setting performance measures for those might be very hard. So I'm just wondering... Yeah, yeah.
The difficulty also is if, as many organisations do, go to worst case, you're going to end up with a lot more critical controls because you're going to have a greater number of high consequence risks. But you would have seen a trip over here and I could hit my head on the corner of there and I could die. So trip, slip and the fall in the workplace ends up as a severe consequence. So if we actually get some better estimates around the data, or sorry, around the consequence, we reduce the number. There's no doubt about it. But it does take time. I certainly am doing some work with a childcare aged care, same thing, only older. Doing some stuff with an aged care lot at the moment, and they've got 17 different aged care facilities. First thing I did was to take out all the risk registers out of the aged care facilities. Because A, they were looked at once every 3 to 6 months. Nobody knew what was in them. So what we've done is brought it back to one register, and now the control framework is informing what it is that these guys need to report back to ensure that those risks are effective. Does that take time? Absolutely, it takes time. But for me, if you're not measuring control effectiveness, if you're not actually measuring control effectiveness, then why are we making an assessment on it? Because it's nothing more than a guess. A judgment. Look at that. Oh, okay. Okay.
So my question relates a little bit to that. With embedding risk management in organisations, so first of all, people don't like change, and secondly, they don't like to do more work.
Mm-hmm.
So by having all these control effectiveness measurements and KPIs, how do you practically balance the amount of work or the resources that go into that against the pragmatism of risk management, just being able to go out and do something about problem,
mm-hmm.
but also not overburdening employees of the organisation?
It's a really good question, man, and it's one I had at a presentation the other day, was that the reality is this. We're actually now not having a discussion around risk management. We're actually taking risk away from just being this thing that we do every 3 to 6 months where people have got to put registers out. But it gets back to that question. If we're doing these things and we're regulated and legislated to do them, there's an expectation from the regulators that we are measuring the effectiveness of those. This should be business as usual. We should be measuring what we're trying to achieve. Now, does that take a little bit more effort? Absolutely. But once you integrate it with your internal audit program and your control self-assessments and so forth, you will find that it just starts to run along. It will take a little bit to set up in the short term, there's no doubt about it. But I can't get away from this notion of just because you've got a risk register, you're managing risk. Because if you've got a risk register that you're looking at every 3 to 6 to 12 months, it's not managing risk. We're just doing risk management. Or worse still, in some organisations, being seen to do risk management because it's a compliance obligation that we have to do it. What I'm trying to do is to have a conversation with organisations to take it away from that, to say, you want to manage your risks, you're trying to stop these things happening. The way you stop these things happening is to have those controls in place. The way that you know those controls are working is to measure those controls. And if you do that, you're not going to be doing all of this crisis management over here. Is that my best side? Oh, I thought you were taking a photo there. Selfie. Senior management support and buy-in is very, very important in this case. Right? And it differs in organisation to organisation. Certainly there are some who come kicking and screaming. There are some who recognise that they've got 150, 200 risks in their risk register, but stuff's still happening. And they ask me the question, why is the stuff still happening? And if you can structure it, then you can put a change management program in around it. And it's just like any other change, but we're not actually doing anything new in reality. We're just tightening up what we're already doing and getting more. I mean, performance frameworks are one of those things that I see need a lot of work in many organisations. Many organisations.
Well, I'd like thank you very much, Rod, for that presentation. I don't think this is on. I think it was a really insightful way of looking at prioritising effort. That's what I was thinking in terms of, you know, management buy-in. Whether it's prioritising resources for future actions or checking on controls, it means the scarce resources. How do you work out what you deal with first?
Cheers.
I'd like everyone to join me in thanking Rod for an excellent presentation.
If you'd like to read more, there's a blog. There's two blogs on my website. The last two, one on control effectiveness, one on a change of the way we look at likelihood. So, paladinrisk.com.au. Do yourself a favour.